The Chicago Digital Accessibility and Inclusive Design Meetup presents United Airlines Accessibility Journey.
I'm going to present United Airlines Accessibility Journey. The agenda tonight will be just a little bit of introduction of why we even visited accessibility, some background, as well as sort of the plan that we took and how we executed on that plan. If there's time, I will do a demonstration and then sort of communicate, you know, what our plans are for the future. And then there'll hopefully be a little bit of time for some Q&A. So, some background. Many of you may or may not know this, but United Airlines was created by William Boeing, who started out in the airplane business in 1916. His company, the Boeing Airplane Company, was, as it was called then, achieved the first international postal delivery in 1919. He went on to establish the United Aircraft Corporation in 1928. Speeding up to today, it's one of, United Airlines is one of the fastest, largest airlines, definitely not fastest. What was I saying there? In the world, with over 87,000 employees and more than 700 mainline aircraft. In 2016, we flew approximately 143 million passengers, serving more than 330 destinations in 54 countries with more than 4,500 daily departures. Okay. Tech for All. Tech for All is the agency, the consultancy that we used to help us out with our accessibility endeavor. They have been around since 2001. Their mission is to serve clients with a commitment to make their product, services, and websites accessible to all people, including those living with disabilities. They provide end-to-end accessibility solutions for a wide range of digital products, applications, and websites, and also for producers of digital content. When we were going through the agencies to figure out which one to go with, they had some airline experience, but they were very heavy in the higher education field. But some of their work that they did in that field, we found interesting and sort of, you know, caused us to look at them a little bit closer. TFA services include training, planning, design and development support, evaluation, testing, remediation, implementation, and monitoring. Support for United Airlines since March of 2015 for accessibility of its website, airport kiosks, mobile apps, and in-flight Wi-Fi portal. So the reason why we involved them was due to the Air Carriers Access Act. How many people here have actually heard of that? Okay, about a third to almost a half. You know, air travel for the longest period of time has been viewed as a luxury, but nowadays it is the main form of moving from point A to point B, especially since people travel not only from town to town, but actually from state to state and country to country. So the Air Carrier Access Act actually prohibits discrimination on the basis of disability in air travel and requires air carriers to accommodate the needs of passengers with disabilities. It's not just for the web, it's actually, you know, when you have someone with a disability who boards an aircraft, getting them to the aircraft, getting them off the aircraft. As you may know, we have been in the news in the past for some issues with that. So the Air Carriers Access Act actually covers not only digital, but actually in the real world. So in 2013, there was an amendment to this rule requiring both US and foreign air carriers to make their websites that market air transportation to the general public in the United States accessible to individuals with disabilities, in addition to kiosks, at least 25% by 2022. So what does this mean for United Airlines? Back in 2013, when this came out in November 2013, we knew nothing about accessibility or what it meant to be accessible. So we really had to start from scratch. You know, people with disabilities have to be able to use the website, perceive, understand, navigate, and interact with the website. The WCAG 2, what I just mentioned a little while ago, those accessibility guidelines provide some direction, techniques, and success criteria that can be used to ensure website accessibility to address various disabilities. So the question was, how are we going to do this? We had to review our flight plan. So first steps, we need to review the needs, outline plans, get up to speed with the guidelines. And you know, the guidelines, as you'll find out next month, it's, I think it's over 1,000 pages of information that you need to digest. So it's really not something that is just, you know, cliff notes, read it, okay, I'm ready to go. We went through a process of selecting an accessibility consulting firm to audit the website, provide recommendations, and sort of the next steps of how we were going to remediate the website. Internally, we did not have a formal team. Basically, it was people with various focuses and disciplines that, and on a part-time basis, worked with our agency to remediate the website. Involved user experience, front-end web development, user acceptance testing, requirements writing, digital production, and editorial disciplines. We also joined an organization called Airlines for America. They're not accessibility specific. They work as a liaison between the airlines and the DOT to ensure that we are following the rules. So to get to the implementation plan, we went through various phases. So phase one was evaluation. We performed website audits of not only United.com, but mobile apps, content migration audit. We were actually in the midst of a CMS migration from one to another, which actually we stopped doing midstream. So there was quite a bit of double work. We reviewed the 2.0 design. So when I say 1.0 and 2.0, what you see today as on the home page and the booking path, that is considered 2.0. 1.0 is the old look. So when I'm referring to these different versions, you'll know what I'm referring to. And then our vendor also created an accessibility discovery and roadmap. Phase two was the actual remediation. So we received training by TFA, both designers and developers, on how to make things accessible. We received guidance and expertise by TFA for the various remediation teams. We, because of the amount of work to be performed, we had to break up into sort of into agile pods to, you know, to audit all the various parts. And mind you, one thing that's unique to airline websites, especially ones that have merged and not replatformed, is that you have a lot of old code. I mean, I cannot tell you how many times I saw a font tag out there. So after we performed the remediation, TFA would perform additional reviews through various working sessions we held. And they also coordinated usability testing with disability groups. December of 2014, I'm sorry, 2015, we partnered with, I'm trying to think of the name. It's a disability group that helps individuals with vision impairments in particular, but they also helped us with various other disabilities come in for testing. I have to say, it's probably one of the most rewarding days in accessibility was actually watch someone succeed and fail in using the website. One of the revelations that I encountered was someone who, the WCAG guidelines say that you have to be able to zoom the website up to 200%. Well, I watched people zooming the website up to 500%. And as you can imagine, there's a lot of moving around to actually be able to digest the content. So, and then phase three was the actual implementation. So as far as executing on this plan, we had three different teams of experts: web, kiosk, and the team working on the accessibility roadmap. So phase one was three parallel tracks to complete web audits in 5 weeks. When you see the number of things we had to audit and review, 5 weeks is amazing. I still don't know how it was done. Phase two, the web team supported remediation and evaluated the results of that remediation. And then phase three was the actual implementation. We had a web team working on the actual implementation of the 2015 and 16 deadlines. The DOT mandated accessibility in two phases. The first phase, which was 2015, was for the seven core functions. That's primarily your booking, your loyalty, check-in, flight status, those sort of task-based functions of a airline website. 2016 was everything else. We had a separate kiosk team who worked to make the kiosks compliant with the DOT regulations, and that was at the end of 2016. TFA, our agency, then addressed the continuing compliance. So before we started this implementation, the disability community really struggled with our website due to various barriers. Not a person with disability, but in the early stages when I was trying to create awareness, I got one of our managing directors in a conference room. And so this way he would understand the gravity of accessibility problems. I set him up with a laptop. I set him up with a mouse. And I said, okay, go ahead and book a flight from the homepage. As he went over to reach the mouse, I quickly unplugged it. So he thought I was rather rude. So then his hands went to the trackpad, and I placed cardboard over it. And I told him, okay, now book. And I said, be glad I didn't turn off the screen. So he, just using the keyboard, attempted to book a flight, and he never got off the homepage. At that point, he was blown away. I think he uttered an expletive. And our internal movement really took off after that. So before the remediation, blind customers, multiple WCAG 2 and some usability issues created major barriers for users with a screen reader, rendering most of our new website booking path interface inaccessible. One of the problems was that the new website had gone through so much development and we were so far along that it wasn't like we could change the design, which is another reason why you really want to bake in accessibility up front at the design stage, even in the planning for design stage. Low vision customers found issues with insufficient color contrast for text and sometimes even using color as a reference. We had portions of our website where we would say, click the green button. If you've ever viewed a web page or website with an extension on the browser that can change it based on different color blindness deficiencies, you'll soon realize that you don't know what button to click. For mobility impaired customers, many of our user interface elements could not be operated using only the keyboard. I kid you not, as I was coming over here, I was telling some folks who arrived here early, a new section of the website that is getting ready to be launched, come to find out that certain things weren't looked at for accessibility. So they reached out to me, and the first they said, okay, so when we get here, when we tap through, we can't get to that button over there. Now the funny thing is I had to be logged in and I was having difficulty logging in, so they sent me a screenshot, which doesn't really make it easy to review the code if they're not providing the code panel. So I said, explain to me what happens. They said, well, we tab, we hit this, and then we hit this, which is right after the button. I said, I can probably guess that that's not a button nor an input. That's probably a div that's wrapped around text that says continue. And there's no tab index. There's nothing saying that it's a button, so you don't know how to interact with it. And then the person on the call this morning, they looked and said, yeah, how did you know? It's like, because I've seen it 350 other times in the last couple years. So at least I could tell them how to fix that. Another thing that we encountered during this journey of ours is the disability community really communicated their displeasure with our website. These are three tweets before we implemented the first phase of implementation. For those who can't see, this is a little bit small, but this was actually during a conference where they used our website as an example. Yes. A bad example before remediation. And it says here, United website doesn't allow blind people to buy flights online. Yikes. And then the hashtags accessibility and user test, please. Over here we have United. I have had a similar problem. General website inaccessibility on Chrome for the Mac. Fine on Firefox. Tweeted on Thursday. Got nothing. And then lastly, United, I use minimum font size in my browser for accessibility, but now the new website won't let me search for flights. Page is broken. As you can imagine, that's an issue. We're basically blocking people from performing a task that other people using a mouse or other input devices are able to do. Additionally, we received feedback. This is an early version in development of the website. And if you notice, we have a lot of issues. This is, once again, a little bit small, but you can see that there's plenty of color contrast issues, text over photographic imagery where you can't read it, small font sizes. Personal tangent. What is up with the small font sizes? I'm over a half a century old, and anytime I have to get within a foot of the monitor, read it, it's too small. So yeah, please increase those font sizes. Trust me, it's going to be a trend. It's going to be sexy someday. Just enlarge it. Being able to use a website is sexy. There you go. And also consistently poor feedback and ratings from customers. That will actually do it each and every time. So a safety check. Key challenges. We had to educate everyone involved in both general understanding as well as specific role-based learning and training on accessibility, both in-house and offshore resources. At the time, we had, for 2.0, we had onshore resources remediating, and for 1.0, we had offshore. The problem there is we had to use a completely different methodology in writing up requirements. For onshore, we were told not to tell how to remediate, just what to remediate. For offshore, we were told not only how to remediate, but, I mean, what to remediate, but explicitly how to remediate it. So you found us many times asking, okay, who's remediating this? Okay, and then we had to write the requirements appropriately. Buy-in of internal stakeholders, educating them on the scope and ramifications of the project, and then the placement of the business priorities. As you can imagine, releasing a new website design, especially one that had been delayed for quite some time, and now everyone wants their portion of the website to look new, look brand new, and we say, we can't do that. We're actually making it accessible, and there may not be any visible changes. That's very difficult to sell to a business stakeholder. And then also, as far as resources, the part-time team with multiple responsibilities. So for myself, I was helping, you know, set remediation requirements for the various parts of 2.0 website for the first phase. Last year, I was divided amongst the rest of the site in helping with the remediation, but also remediating the rest of the site for content. So last year was a very busy year. Design and development of a new website already in progress requiring remediation rather than design. Very costly. Remediation is always more costly than baking it in upfront at the beginning. Time to completion and scope. You know, you would think that we had a total for the entire website of 3 years to make it accessible. You don't realize how much time you really need. We literally finished about a week before. So it was very stressful. The scope of the mandate required us to divide and conquer, address kiosk software and hardware, split the website into core pages, content-driven pages, and third-party vendor responsibilities. We have a lot of subdomains that are actually managed by third parties, and then trying to get them up to speed. What we wanted to do is say, here's WCAG, learn it, fix the website. They still came to us asking us questions all the time, so that really did not work. Partnerships. Integration of accessibility partner into implementation activities. We brought TFA, our partner, at appropriate touch points from audit to recommendations to training. We did, again, usability testing by people with disabilities. And we also started developing relationships with various groups. Most recently, we created a relationship with the American Federation of the Blind and the Chicago Lighthouse for the Blind. And then, of course, the logistical challenges in terms of equipment, devices, tools, online versus in-person. We could only do testing in-person. You know, for other user testing that we do a mix. But with individuals with disabilities, that's very difficult, if not impossible, because the methods in doing remote testing are themselves not accessible. And then ongoing training, continuing to spread the word to others where training and education becomes important. I'm still doing that today. One of the things that we found is as soon as you train people, people leave and now you got to train new people. The groups themselves don't keep the information. They don't, you know, they don't create a knowledge base within their groups. They depend on us to retrain and recreate awareness. Different disciplines and practices that have different roles, learning how to do their part and how they fit together. One of the things I will say on the positive is we had some tremendous advocates in the business. Because then she'd probably kick me in the shins tomorrow. But she's on the advertising side. So you think, okay, so what? What's the big deal? Ads themselves also have to be accessible. And you would not think that this would be so difficult. But when you're dealing with third-party ads using APIs that hit a distribution system, which are hitting a source system, that can be very difficult. And this particular individual really hung in there, wanted to learn, embraced it, and really made my life much easier. So, like ad banners. And for these particular ones, these were third party ads. No. So takeoff. So in 2015 and 16, here's where we round up some numbers here. There were 1,421 application pages that needed to be remediated. And again, you know, seeing the same problems over, and that's actually a blessing. When you establish a pattern where this table's coded just like this table and they're all bad, you could sort of just write the requirements for each one of these the same way. So that actually did help us. But, I mean, font tags. Come on. I actually had to think, what are the attributes for a font tag? How does this work? 600 content pages, 26 videos. Now you may think, okay, what's the big deal? Well, 26 videos that did not have custom captions. They had YouTube's auto captions. Well, we all know what that's like. I watched, when we first started this, I watched in-flight safety video. And I watched the auto captions. I mean, talk about damaging to the brand. I mean, yeah, even some of those words should not be used in anything that's on video for United Airlines. But besides that, not only the captions, but how we are delivering them. You know, just embedding the YouTube player. YouTube player's not up to WCAG 2AA. So we had to find a player that would handle YouTube videos. And then, of course, we found all the issues with regards to that. You might think, okay, fine, that's perfect and you're done. Not when you realize that there's information embedded in the video that's not being passed across audibly. So you can have captions, but now, you know, there's, like, for instance, for our in-flight entertainment, they would embed the name of the film, but it's never being communicated. Well, isn't that the point of the video? To know what videos are going to be displayed, you know, are going to be presented in flights for a given month? So, and then 108 PDFs. God, PDFs. What can I say? It's funny, we had 2 days of training on how to remediate PDFs. And then about a month later, we said, yeah, that's not going to work. So then we just started hitting the delete key.
I was gonna say, less PDFs.
Exactly, and but touch upon here, we began with over 1,600 PDFs. We're left with 108. Many of those, believe it or not, were back from 2001. How relevant were those? Our web servers in some areas are basically storage servers. You know, mergers and acquisitions and things like that. Challenges include video player, closed captioning, route map. Okay. So our old route map, we had two of them, one domestic, one international, and they were PDFs. I think each PDF had about 1,200 curved lines going from various hubs. And I would tell the design group who would actually update these on a monthly basis, it's like, you do realize that I can't get nothing out of this. Oh, yes, you can. I said, so what route did you add? I added this route. I go, where's the line? So our current route map uses the Google Maps API. It provides the information textually, but also allows for the graphical lines that you would expect. So it's actually pretty cool. Friendly skies. That's what we want, right? After our remediation, we immediately started getting positive feedback. This is a tweet here. Nice job, United, on the new website. Thanks for moving the web forward with your attention paid to accessibility. This is an email that we actually received. The key here is noticed improvements in the ability to select a fare and seat from the seat map. Great stuff. I can't tell you how valuable, how impactful it is to make a seat map accessible to individuals with disabilities. The key here in making things accessible is providing independence for everyone. We take it for granted because we've been doing it forever. It's not until you don't have it, and especially if you once had it and now you don't, you have something to compare to. And that's when it becomes very impactful. We actually made Marcy Sutton's blog. She runs a blog called Accessibility Wins, where basically she points out accessibility wins. Typically, there are little portions of a website. In this case, she just targeted the entire website and said, great job. So you might want to check that out and read the entire article on that. Another thing we noticed is that we have Opinion Labs hooked up to the website. You'll notice that little green tab, which, by the way, now is accessible. It's pretty bad when you make the website accessible, but yet if someone wants to provide feedback, they can't get to it. We had to make that accessible. Right after implementation of our accessibility, you notice that we went from this many complaints down to practically none. Now, it's not to say that we're perfect. In fact, if you think of it, a website's constantly changing. We won an award. The American Federation of the Blind awarded United Airlines their Blind Access Award. The Access Award honors individuals and corporations that eliminate or substantially reduce inequities faced by people with vision loss. We actually received this award last Friday. Representatives from our team that did much of the remediation attended the ceremony last Friday. So the project really was to remediate the website, but you have to think about, okay, what about the future? I mean, how are you going to keep the website accessible? So we are looking at applying universal design principles. We have recently started moving to Agile. Yeah, I know it's taken a while. But one of the challenges is with that is to make sure each pod is at the same level of universal design and incorporating accessibility. That's something that we're having to deal with at this current time. Automated testing tools. A little bit over a year ago, we met with at least 8 vendors of automated testing tools, things like Tenon and the SSB BART, I think it's called AMP, their product. We met with various vendors. They demonstrated their tools. Some of them are free. Some of them are very pricey. It basically is based on how much of a dashboard they provide. Today, we still do not have an automated tool implemented. Now, there's actually 2 types of tools. So there's your manual tool like WebAIM that can test page by page. And then there's tools like Tenon and other things that will actually scan a group of pages, if not the entire website. We don't have that yet. But with either tool, whether it be a page-based or site-based, automated tools are only good up to about 30%. So they're going to catch your low-hanging fruit. They're going to catch whether you're missing an alt attribute. You know, code-based patterns, they're going to catch if you don't have a label tag associated with an input field, but they're not going to catch if, you know, you have the word file name in as the alt text for an ad, let's say. So they're not going to test on the more qualitative things. Okay, documenting. I don't think to this day we have spotty documentation here and there, but we don't have an actual global set of documentation. And I know that We are working on that. We need to continue our usability testing with customers with disabilities. Again, someone like me who doesn't, I don't have a disability per se. I mean, I'm wearing glasses. This is my assistive technology. But I don't have a disability per se. So that's very different from me testing as compared with an actual user who depends on things, who will have a very different experience. And then with regards to the kiosk, we've completed and launched them, but that's an ongoing thing. We're constantly replacing kiosks, and those are, you know, the software is complete, the hardware is being rolled out as the airports update their kiosks. And then, of course, the continuing in-person education. Also changing the culture. That's been another quite difficult thing in a company like ours, to create a culture where we do include everyone. I have had a designer come to me and say, but blind people don't come to our website. It's like, have you been to the airport lately? Have you seen people with guide dogs and canes boarding planes? How do you think they got there? Not all of them used someone to book their flight. Many of them actually booked their own flight. Okay, and we're also looking at the in-flight Wi-Fi and entertainment because we know that's coming down. The mobile app, our mobile app fluctuates in accessibility. Sometimes it's better, then someone will make a change and it's a little bit worse. But actually it's fairly accessible. MWeb, which is gonna be our mobile web that we roll out later on this year, as well as the internal flight attendance apps. So, you know, it's been, for me, it's been a 3+ year journey from grassroots to very structured remediation and then program building, which is where we are today. And it's all sort of to make the skies more friendly, or the friendly skies. So.
This presentation was given by Dennis Deacon, Accessibility Specialist, United Airlines. Venue sponsorship by Critical Mass at criticalmass.com. Captioning service by ACS, Alternative Communication Services, at acscaptions.com. Caption sponsored by McDonald's. McDonald's.com. We're loving it. Thanks to our sponsor, Rosenfeld Media, at rosenfeldmedia.com. Thanks to our sponsor, Sticker Giant, at stickergiant.com. Thanks to our sponsor, O'Reilly Media, at shop.oreilly.com. This presentation produced by the Chicago Digital Accessibility and Inclusive Design Meetup. Visit us at meetup.com/A11YCHI. Follow us on Twitter at twitter.com/A11YCHI. Follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/groups/A11YCHI.